Respected elders, brothers, friends, ladies listening at home, we were sitting here some time ago talking about Hazrat Pirani Peer Sayyidina Abdul Qadir Jilani Rahmatullahi Alayh. This was because some people say we don't believe in awliyas. Far from truth. We are the real believers of awliyaullah. Alhamdulillah. Awliyaullah are the great friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We believe in them, we revere them, we respect them. We try to follow in their footsteps. Believing in them does not mean worshipping them. As we mentioned in the previous talk, that belief, the true belief in awliyaullah is through emulating them, imitating them, following the path which they took, so that we can also become awliya of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's world is never deprived from awliyaullah. In every era, there are great awliyaullah. If these awliyaullah finish and they are wiped out and you just say, oh, they were the great awliyaullah of the past, you don't have those today, then that means that Deen Islam is incomplete, it's naqis. Then Ummate Muhammadiyya is deprived from a great blessing of the great friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That can't be true. In every era, there are great awliyaullah, friends of Allah, those who attach themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and those who submit themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who have no concern except for the hereafter and except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So among those great awliyaullah, we all many a times hear the name of Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi Rahmatullahi Alayh. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi Rahmatullahi Alayh was born in the year 215 after Hijrah. And he passed away in the year 297 or 98 after Hijrah. So this is the time which can be classed as a part of the golden era. Because it's the time of Tabi Tabi'een. Sahaba, Tabi'een, Tabi Tabi'een is the time of great Aimmas like Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi. Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi was born in the year 194 after Hijrah and he passed away in the year 256. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi was born in the year 164 after Hijrah and passed away in the year 241 after Hijrah. So you can see the era is very close. Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayh, his kunyat is Abu al-Qasim al-Junaid ibn Muhammad ibn al-Junaid al-Khazaz al-Qawariri rahmatullahi alayh. He was born in Baghdad. Originally his family are from Nihavand. You must have heard the name Nihavand. It's in the northern side of Iran where the great battle of Nihavand took place. Khalid bin Walid radiyallahu anhu was the victorious and the one who gained victory in that Maidan and in that battlefield. It's one of the famous battles of the time of Sahaba Ridwanullahi Alayhi Majma'i. So his family are from Nihavand. They had moved to Baghdad and it is here that Junaid Baghdadi Rahmatullahi Alayhi was born in the year 215 after Hijrah. He was born like other Mashayikh in noble family, Alhamdulillah. His uncle, his mamu, Khalu, Hazrat Sari Saqati rahmatullahi alayhi, was one of the great saints and awliyaullah of that time. And he could see the light and of Iman and Nur in Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi at a very tender age. Once, at the age of 7, Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi was playing with his friends. And Sari Saqati rahmatullahi alayhi with other Sufiyas and Buzrugs was sitting in a gathering and they were debating about the reality of shukr, being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the reality of shukr? And Sari Saqati rahmatullahi alayhi along with the others, they were putting forward their explanation and definition of shukr. They asked this young boy of 7, young boy, what is shukr? And he looked at his mamu and he said, Allah ta'asi Allah bi ni'amihi. Shukr is that you don't disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Even though you are being showered and blessed by the blessings and ni'mats of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you look at the ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how Allah is blessing you with His ni'mats and bounties and favors and blessings, you ponder over that and you show your gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the reality of shukr. And Sari Saqati said, look at this young boy of 7. And the definition he is given is correct, to the point. And he said, أَخَافُ أَنْ يَكُونَ حَظُّكَ مِنَ اللَّهِ لِسَانُكَ. I fear that your portion, your share from Allah will be your tongue only. Meaning you will be a great speaker, great orator, and you will be a great professor or master of speeches. And Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi went on to become such a person. And sometimes he said, I would cry when I would remember this remark of my uncle, that I've got nothing but speaking, I don't have any actions, any a'mal, deed, I only go around speaking, whereas I myself don't practice as much as I should. So he said, I fear because of that remark which my uncle made a long time ago when I was only a boy of 7. So Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi was from a noble family. He grew up in a noble manner. He went to his asatiza. Among his asatiza was Faqih Abu Thawr, who was in the beginning of a Hanafi madhab. Then when Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi arrived at Baghdad, he sat in the company of Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi. He learned from Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi. And then he developed his own fiqh. And he had his own fiqh as well. And there were some people who used to follow the fiqh of Abu Thawr rahmatullahi alayhi. So Abu Thawr rahmatullahi alayhi was a great faqih, muhaddith of that time. Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi went to learn from him, sat in his company. And at the age of 20, he would give fatwa in the gathering of Hazrat Abu Thawr rahmatullahi alayhi. Faqih Abu Thawr would refer questions to Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi, and he would give answers and reply. And he had a very intelligent brain, intelligent mind. He was very swift in answers and he had that special ability and intelligence, wisdom to answer questions with the shortest possible manner and in a beautiful way. So Faqih Abu Thawr also used to like him. And among his mashayikh in the line of tasawwuf was Al-Harith ibn Asad Al-Muhasibi, and his uncle Sari Al-Saqati, and Abu Ja'far Al-Qassab, and others. Hazrat Harith ibn Asad Al-Muhasibi, he was one of the great saints and awliyaullah of his time. Some people debated his condition, and they talked about some of the wordings which he used. However, Shamsuddin al-Zahabi rahmatullahi alayhi has declared him as al-Abid al-Zahid al-Sufi, Imamu Ahli Tasawwuf. Hafiz ibn Hajar rahmatullahi alayhi has also praised him. And Ibn al-Amad also said good words regarding Harith ibn Asad al-Muhasibi. So he was a great wali of Allah. Hazrat Shaykh Nawarullahu Marqadahu has narrated some of his quotes at the end of Fadail al-Sadaqat. How he would scold the ulama of the time. And he would say to them, O ulama of time, you have fell for the dunya. You want money all the time. You go around, you teach people just for money. You have no concern of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ikhlas has deserted you. And you have no sincerity in you. You say that we need to be wealthy. You say that Abdul Rahman ibn Auf was wealthy. You say that Usman Ghani was wealthy. Tell me, did they use the wealth like you do? Or did they used to spend in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do you spend like they used to spend, like Usman Ghani used to spend, like Abdul Rahman ibn Auf used to spend? You are never within miles of Usman Ghani and Abdul Rahman ibn Auf. How can you claim that you want to be Ghani like Usman and Abdul Rahman? You are ulamas. You should be denouncing the world. You should be running away from the world. You should be attaching yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In this manner, he would reprimand the group of the ulama. Hazrat Shaykh has narrated these words of wisdom, of zuhud and ibadat and asceticism in Fadail al-Sadaqat. You can read it at the end. So Harith ibn Asad al-Muhasibi was a great saint of his time. There are many quotes narrated from him. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi used to stay in his company, in his suhbah, and learn from him. Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi said that Harith ibn Asad al-Muhasibi's father left behind lots of wealth, and he was supposed to be the inheritor. But Harith said, I don't want to be the heir and the inheritor of my father. This is because ye musibat hai. La ilaha illallah. Usko band kar do. Hadith ibn Asad al-Muhasibi said that he said that I don't want to be a warith and inheritor of my father, because the hadith has said that if your religion and mazhab is different, then inheritance is not allowed. And my father had some beliefs which go according to the firqa of Waqifi. Like we have different firqas and groups and sects today. So his father belonged to the sect of Waqifi. So he said, I don't want a penny from the miras of my father. And he gave it all in sadaqah. So Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi says, he used to say, تَرْكُ الدُّنْيَا مَعَ ذِكْرِهَا صِفَةُ الزَّاهِدِينَ وَتَرْكُهَا مَعَ نِسْيَانِهَا صِفَةُ الْعَارِفِينَ. Abandoning the dunya and denouncing the luxuries of the world while mentioning it is the sifat, an attribute of zahideen, those who have zuhd in the dunya. However, tarkuha ma'a nisyaniha sifatul arifin. Leaving the world while forgetting is the sifat of al-arifin. If you have ma'rifat in your heart, then you will leave the world and you won't even think about it. If you leave the world but you still think about it, you can be classed as a zahid. But if you think about, if you just forget it, then that is the sifat of arifin. He would say al-ilm yurithu al-makhafa. والزهد يورث الراحة والمعرفة تورث الإنابة. That ilm brings around with it khawf and fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And zuhd brings around with it rahat and sukoon and peace of mind. And ma'rifat brings with it inabat and turning and yearning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he is saying three things: ilm and zuhd and ma'rifat. If you have ilm, you will have fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Quran has said, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. Ulama fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you learn ilm of deen, if you have knowledge of deen, then this knowledge of deen will bring into you fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you have zuhud, if you denounce the luxuries and the pleasures of the world, you don't fall for the pomp and glitter of this world, then this will bring you peace of mind, sukoon. Because people will be after money, and they want this and that, this car, house, this, running around all the time. But you don't want anything like that. You will get peace and tranquility and sukoon in your heart. And if you have ma'rifat, gnosis, the recognition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this will make you humble. And this will create within you inabat and rujoo' ila Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You will turn to Allah, you will yearn for Him, you will remember Him at all times. These are some of the words of wisdom of Hazrat Harith ibn Asad al-Muhasibi, in whose company Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi used to sit. Also, Hazrat Sari Saqati rahmatullahi alayhi, a great wali of his time, 251 is the year of death. He was a great zahid. How did he become a zahid? His Shaykh is Hazrat Ma'ruf al-Karkhi rahmatullahi alayhi. Now Ma'ruf al-Karkhi rahmatullahi alayhi, he was a new Muslim, he was a revert. He himself was from a Christian family, and he embraced Islam. But he went on to become one of the greatest awliyaullah of his time. Someone saw a dream and in which he saw Hazrat Bishr ibn al-Harith rahmatullahi alayhi. And he saw that Bishr ibn al-Harith al-Hafi, Bishr al-Hafi, he was sitting and there were luxuries and fruits around him, and the malaika and the angels were feeding him that food while he was sitting chuffed on a couch and reclining on it. And the malaika were feeding him the food of Jannah. So he asked them that who is this and why is he being blessed with this ni'mat? And they replied, this is Bishr al-Hafi rahmatullahi alayhi. He used to fast continuously in the dunya for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah has rewarded him with the food of Jannah, and the malaika are feeding him the food. In the same dream, he saw that Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi was standing at the gates of Jannah. And he was inviting people inside, come to the Jannah, come to the Jannah. And people were answering his call and going inside Jannah. This was very clear, because Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi was a great faqih and alim. And he was spreading the ilm among people and calling people towards Jannah. And in the same dream, he saw that Ma'ruf al-Karkhi rahmatullahi alayhi was sitting and continuously looking at something. So he asked someone that who is this and what is he looking at? And they replied that this is Ma'roof Al-Qalqi Rahmatullahi Ali. He spent his whole life in ibadat and worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, he did not worship Allah for fear of Jahannam, or he did not worship Allah to get Jannah. He worshipped Allah only for Allah. He only wanted the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He wanted to make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala happy. And for the happiness of and pleasure of Allah, he worshipped Allah. So as soon as he came here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed him to look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he is there sitting, observing the countenance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was Ma'roof Al-Qarqi rahmatullahi alayhi, who was the Shaykh of Sari Saqati rahmatullahi alayhi. Sari Saqati rahmatullahi alayhi says that I used to go to the market to buy and sell. I had a stall in the market. So, however, I like Ma'roof Al-Qarqi. I would go and sit in his company as well. So, one day, he came in the market. And with him was an orphan, a yatim, an orphan child. And he said, Ya Sari, uksu hadha al-yatim. This yatim needs some good clothes. Give him some clothes. So, I immediately brought real nice, beautiful clothes. And I put them on the yatim. And the yatim was happy. And Ma'roof Qalqi rahmatullahi alayhi was also happy. And while he was there, due to that happiness, he gave me a dua. And he said, بَغَّضَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ الدُّنْيَا وَأَرَاحَكَ مِمَّا أَنْتَ فِيهِ. May Allah develop the hatred of dunya in your heart and give you rahat and sukoon from the condition you are in. So he said, he gave this dua. May Allah develop the bughz of dunya in your heart. May you start hating the dunya and you get rahat and sukoon from all this busyness which you are in. And he said, as soon as Ma'roof left, I felt that this bughz of dunya, what is this dunya, 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 paye dunya, yuhi bak bak ke abas jaan khapai, nadiya manzil uqba ka mujhe rasta dikhai. But ye dunya bak bak kya iske piche? He said, let's leave the dunya. And he said, I left everything and I just went into his company. And then he went on to become a Sari Saqati rahmatullahi alayhi. Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi used to say, ma ra'aytu a'bada minhu. I have never seen anyone worshipping Allah more than Sari Saqati, my uncle, rahmatullahi alayhi. He was at the age of 78. And he was never seen lying down on the floor except at the time of his death. That is the only time someone saw him lying down. Otherwise, he would never be seen lying down. Either praying, standing, or in ruku, sujood, or sitting down in his tasbih and azkar. And if he want to sleep, just sleep a little bit while he is sitting down. He wouldn't sleep while lying down on the floor. And the reason for that was, once he was lying down in his youth. And he saw a dream. In some which, he was lying down in the masjid. And someone said, you are claiming to be a Sufi and lying down in the masjid, sleeping. You shouldn't be sleeping like this. And he said, I just woke up from there and I made an oath that I will never lie down to sleep. And he spent his life in ibadat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this was Hazrat Sari Saqati rahmatullahi alayhi, the uncle of Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi, and from whose sohbat Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi went on to become whatever Junaid Baghdadi was. Now, Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi himself was a great personality. I heard this story somewhere in a bayan, but I couldn't find it in the books which I have in front of me. Allah knows best. That Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi in his earlier age was a very strong person, and he would sometimes be involved in wrestling, and no one could beat him in wrestling. And he was declared as the official Shahi wrestler, the royal wrestler, who was unbeatable. And the king had great pride in him. So once the king made a challenge, that if someone beats my wrestler Junaid Baghdadi, I will reward him with so and so huge amount. So nobody accepted the challenge. One person who was of an average build, who was not very strong, he came forward and he said, I will wrestle him. So people said, you going to wrestle Junaid? He said, yes, I'm going to wrestle him. Okay. Now, they were put in the ring. And they, when they held on to one another, that person said in the ears of Junaid, that, oh Junaid, look, I have not come here to wrestle. I know I can't beat you. But however, I am a Sayyid. And I am going through hard times. My family is facing poverty. I have nothing to eat. I have just come here that maybe I can beat you and I can get that reward and I can feed my children. If you show yourself beaten and lie down in the floor, I will get the reward, and Allah will reward you for your good deed. Junaid said, okay. And they wrestled for a bit, and then he pinned him down. Junaid was on the floor, and he was on top. And the king said, what is this? And everybody said, no, there's something wrong here. Wrestle again. And again. And the second time, Junaid went down again. And the third time, he went down again. And the king said, there's something wrong. Junaid said, no problem, I'm sorry, I can't beat him. He's very strong. I don't know where he gets his energy from. Thing was finished. And the Sayyid was rewarded with that huge reward. He went away. That night, Junaid Baghdadi, rahmatullah alayhi, saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a dream. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, oh Junaid, you honored my child. I will pray to Allah to give you honor in the dunya. Allah will give you izzat and respect and honor in the dunya. And so happened that Junaid Baghdadi left all that wrestling and whatever habit he had, and he went on to become one of the great awliyaullah of his time. Hazrat Junaid rahmatullah alayhi went on to become wali of Allah, not just like this. He also had, you know, for his livelihood, he had a stall, and he would go to the market, and he would buy and sell. His title is Al-Khazaz. Khazaz means Resham Farosh, seller of silk. So he would buy and sell silk, and silk is expensive, so he would get enough to survive on for his family. So Hazrat Junaid would buy and sell silk, and that is how he would earn his livelihood. He wouldn't wait for any handouts from the king or from others, because the awliyaullah, they were independent, and they would earn their own livelihood. That is the correct way of living. So he would go and earn, in the beginning, he would earn his livelihood. Once he said that he came to the masjid, and there were some people sitting in the masjid, and they were reading their tasbih. However, their heart is attached to the dunya. And they wait for people to come and offer them some gifts and tawfas and feed them. They go out begging people at times. So Junaid Baghdadi, once he was in a state of anger. When he came to the masjid and he saw this condition of the people, he made a remark. He said, there are some people who sit in the masjid, but they don't deserve to sit in the masjid. They deserve to be kicked out of the masjid, because their heart is not in the masjid. Their heart is not attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, there are others in the market who stay in the market and who do their business, but their heart is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They recite 30,000 tasbihat every day, and they pray 300 rakat nafals every day. He was indicating towards himself that in spite of that business and his shughl and his busyness, he would pray 300 rakat nafils every day. And he would pray 30,000 tasbihat every day. So this did not deter him from the ibadat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He would be there. But at the same time, on the shop, on the stall, when you are free, then you can keep reciting your tasbihat. Where the customers are not there, you're not busy, you can read your tasbihat. So he says that reading 30,000 tasbihat. And this was his ma'mool in the beginning. Also, once someone saw a tasbih in his hand and said, فَقِيلَ لَهُ أَنْتَ مَعَ تَمَكُّنِكَ وَشَرَفِكَ تَأْخُذُ بِيَدِكَ سُبْحَةً. O Junaid, you are of such a high caliber, and in spite of your rank, you are holding tasbih in your hand. And he said, نعم سبب وصلنا به إلى ما وصلنا لا نتركه أبدا. This is the reason by which we reach the status which we reached. So we can't leave and abandon this sabab by which we reached Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This tasbih will continuously stay with us, and we have to pray the tasbih, because it is through this tasbih that we reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and gain his ma'rifat and his gnosis. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi, he went on to become a great wali of a great saint, great wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There were times when he gave up all this attachment to dunya, and he would go out into the outskirts and spend some time on the outskirts. Like we mentioned in Hazrat Pirani Pir rahmatullahi alayhi, many times he would go out of Baghdad to the outskirts, in the open areas, in the forests, maybe in the deserts, and spend some time there. Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi, sometimes he would also go out and spend time in the forest, in the desert, in there, on his own seclusion, and he would love that loneliness. And this, you know, staying alone and having Allah in your heart is something amazing. Zunnun Misri rahmatullah alayhi used to say, إِذَا سَكَنَ الْقَلْبَ حُبُّ اللَّهِ أَنَا سَبِ اللَّهِ لِأَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى أَجَلُّ فِي صُدُورِ الْعَارِفِينَ أَنْ يُحِبُّوا سِوَاهُ. When the love of Allah sets inside the heart, then that heart loves being alone and in seclusion with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah's rank in the eyes and the heart of the arifin is so high that they don't want to have uns and with anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why they go out, and in that is the sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to go to Ghari Hira and spend many weeks over there before he was blessed with nabuwat and prophethood? My Hazrat says in one of his bayan, Ghari Hira was not some air-conditioned place like we have air-conditioned houses today. It was very hot place, hot climate in Saudi Arabia, in Makkah Mukarrama. And even the stones and the rocks on which he used to sit, on in which he used to walk, they were extremely hot. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in spite of that heat, in spite of that extreme hot weather, he would find solace and consolation and tasalli and sukoon and peace and rahat in that loneliness, in that seclusion. That's why he used to go and sit there and spend many days. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him with nubuwwat and prophethood. So staying in seclusion, today this has become something alien to us. We don't want to stay lonely. We want always someone around us. If nobody is in the house, we want to put the TV on. Watch something, some movie or something, some program. If we are alone for a little while, we get agitated, disturbed. We don't want to be lonely on our own. This is why even when somebody sits in i'tikaf, he doesn't like that loneliness. He wants to talk to someone. And you know, whenever he gets the chance, he will go out, talk to people, and here and there. He doesn't want to be alone in his mu'takaf and in his hujra. Whereas the aim of i'tikaf is to be alone, not to talk to anyone. Just keep yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Attach yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this should be the case. But today we have alienated ourselves, distanced ourselves from this seclusion and from being alone with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi, many times he would go out onto the outskirts and be on his own. Once he was on his own, and many days had passed, and he didn't have anything to eat. So he was going through faqa upon faqa and poverty, and he liked that condition state. And he says that a young man came, young boy, and he had some water with him, and he sat down to eat. So I looked at him, I said, and I, you know, we started talking, and said, "You are eating, come on, offer me as well." I said, "Okay, come." And he gave him this fruit called hanzal. Now hanzal is something like, you know, aloe vera. It's very bitter. So he said, "Take this." So Junaid Baghdadi thought to himself, then he said, "No, he's given me whatever it is, let me take it." And he took it. When he put it in his mouth, oh ho, it was sweeter than honey. And he couldn't understand what that was. And he gave him something to drink, and that was enough. And the young man had some conversation with Junaid Baghdadi, and then he disappeared, he went away. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi says, thereafter I went for Hajj, and I saw the young man in Haram Sharif. He came from behind, tapped on my shoulder. I looked around and I saw Hoi, and he said, "Do you remember me?" I said, "Yes, I am that." He said, "I am that young man." I said, "What are you doing here? Look at your condition. You have gone weak and frail." And he recited some couplets in which he said, "Allah's love and muhabbat, that has taken all my good health away, and it has brought me over here." And he mentioned that. And what about that? Do you remember that hanzal I gave you? It was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It looked like that bitter fruit, but in reality, it was extremely sweet. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi says, it was my habit that, you know, at the night of Eid and before Eid, he would go out of the city. Because he would not be able to see the luxury and the pomp and the glitter and of all, you know, Eid and that happiness and joy. So he would go out on the outskirts. He said, "I spend the night before Eid on the outskirts on my own in seclusion." In the morning, he says, "I saw this young boy and young man, and he was covered in two sheets, and he started reading some couplets. بِحُرْمَةِ غُرْبَتِي كَمْذَ السُّدُودُ أَلَا تَعْتِفُ عَلَيَّ أَلَا تَجُودُ سرور العيد قد عم النواحي وحزني في ازدياد لا تبيد فإن كنت اقترفت خلال سوء فعذري في الهواء فلا تعود بحرمة غربتي كم ذا السدود. I am a musafir, a traveler. I deserve some honor and respect. How long are you going to keep yourself turning away from me? How long are you going to turn your face away from me? Will you not have some pity on me? Will you not return to me? The joy of Eid has spread around the city. However, my grief is in increase and it's not diminishing and going away. If I have committed any bad habits and bad sins, then the excuse for my bad habits is my hawa and my carnal desire. So I am very sorry for that. I want you to come back to me. These were couplets. Maybe he was talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oh Allah, I am a sinful person. However, I need you. Please turn towards me and have some mercy upon me. Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi says, once I was in Hajj and I was performing tawaf. And I saw this young girl who was also performing tawaf. And she was reciting some couplets of love. And she was saying, Abal hubbu an yakhfa wa kam qad qatamtuhu fa asbaha indi qad anakha wa tannaba. And then she said, وَيَبْدُو مُحَيَّاهُ لِعَيْنَيَّ فِي الْكَرَىٰ. And then she said, فَإِنْ رُمْتُ قُرْبًا مِنْ حَبِيبِي تَقَرَّبًا. My love refuses to be concealed and to stay hidden. I have tried to conceal it and hide it for a long time, but it just comes out into the open all the time. Whenever I want to see him, his countenance and his light is before me, and I can observe him all the time. And when I intend to draw myself closer to him, my beloved himself comes closer to me. So Abu Junaid Baghdadi says that I thought that she was talking, she was in love with someone and talking about her beloved. So I said, "Oh lady, oh young girl, are you not ashamed of yourself? You are reciting such couplets in front of the house of Allah in Haram Sharif." And she said, "Oh, Junaid, you don't know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is His love which has driven my sleep away. It is His love which has made me pale. And it is His love which has taken my good health away from me." And she said, "Oh, Junaid, when you perform the tawaf of Kaaba, do you perform the tawaf of these stones or the tawaf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?" And I said, "Well, I perform the tawaf of this house." I said, "Oh, the stones have diverted you away from the owner of the stones and the owner of the house. When you kiss the stone, Hajar-i Aswad, do you kiss the stone or do you have something else in your mind?" I said, "I kiss the stone." He said, "Oh, you are falling for the stones. You should be thinking you are kissing the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you kiss the Hajar-i Aswad." So he said, "I learned good from this young girl who was an ashiqa and who had great love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." So this is how those who loved Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi himself went on to become a great wali of Allah, saint of Allah. He is regarded as Sayyidu Ta'ifa and he is regarded as the Imam of Ahlul Tasawwuf because he had combined both the Quran, Hadith and Tasawwuf, both of them together. And this is why sometimes he used to say, "Man lam yahfaz al-Qur'an wa lam yaktub al-hadith la yuqtada bihi fi hadha al-amr li'anna 'ilmana muqayyadun bil-kitabi was-sunnah." Whosoever is not hafiz of the Quran and whosoever has not written hadith by going to the muhaddiseen and learning from them, then he will not be followed in this matter of ours, meaning in tasawwuf, because he is a jahil, he is ignorant, he doesn't know the Quran. How can we trust him? He doesn't know the hadith. We will not follow such a person because this ilm tasawwuf of ours is muqayyad and is bound with Quran and Sunnah. In another place, he used to say, "Ilmuna hada mushtabikun bi hadith Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wasallam." This ilm of tasawwuf is interlocked with the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, just as these fingers of mine are interlocked. They are inseparable. You can't separate tasawwuf from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So these are the ulama who follow the shariat, the zahir of shariat, and at the same time they have the batin and the spirit and ruh of shariat in them as well, which is called tariqat. Shariat, tariqat, haqiqat. They have all three in them. They follow the shariat, which is the zahir, like praying, ruku, sajda, zakat, sawm, sadqah, hajj. This is the zahir of shariat. You can't go to tariqat without this zahir. And then after that is tariqat. When you have the reality, the ruh of this ibadat, like everything has a shell. And everything has the maghz and guda inside it. Like the orange, you have the shell, you peel it off, and whatever is inside is there. Similarly, these ibadat are like the shell. And then they have the ruh and spirit and soul inside it. So if we need to bring that soul and spirit in the ibadat, If their soul and spirit is not in the ibadah, our mind is wandering around somewhere, then we won't get the sawab from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, many a times a person prays salah, but he only gets 1/10 of the reward he should be getting. Someone gets 1/9, 1/8, 1/7, 1/6, 1/5, 1/4, 1/3. Some people get half. Very rarely do people get full sawab of their salat. Why? Because wudu is not proper, ruku is not proper, sajda is not proper, khushu' is not proper, concentration is not there. So the sawab reduces and reduces and reduces, and you only get a portion of what you should be getting. That is why you should have that ruh and spirit and soul in your heart, which can elevate your ranks and which can bring you the 100% reward of the ibadat which you are doing. You can only do that if you have the tariqat and tasawuf and ruh in your heart. And after that, you get the wusul ila Allah. Then that is called haqiqat, the gnosis, the ma'rifat, the recognition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi is saying that this is what you need. That is why he says in another place, al-adabu adaban, adabu sirr wa adabu al-alaniya. Fal-awwal taharatu al-qalb min al-uyub wal-alaniya hifzu al-jawarih min al-dhunub. Adab and etiquettes are of two types. One is the adab of the inner part of the heart, and the second is the adab is of the opening and our a'za and jawarih, our limbs. And he said the first one is taharatul qalb min al-uyub, keeping your heart clean from all aib and faults. No aib should be in your heart. The uyub, the sicknesses, the ailments should be driven away from your heart. Your heart should be clean from pride, arrogance, haughtiness, from stinginess, from riya, showing off, from love of dunya, from love of wealth, from love of high rank and position, kursi, from all these bad habits and ailments. You should clean your heart from all these uyub. If you do that, then you will have the adab of sir, of adab of heart, that you will be respecting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through your heart. And the adab of jawarih is that hifzul jawarih min al-dhunub, that you protect your a'za and your limbs from dhunub and from disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You protect your eyes from gazing unlawfully. You protect your ears from listening to things you shouldn't be listening at. You protect your tongue from saying things you shouldn't be saying. You protect your hands from taking, writing, signing things you shouldn't be doing and you should not be taking. Also, you protect your feet from going to the place where you shouldn't be going. So this is the adab and etiquette of the jawarih and the limbs which Allah has given us. So the adab is of sir and the adab of jawarih, limbs. We should have both adab within us. Someone said, "Allimni shay'an yuqarribuni ila Allah wa ila an-nas." He asked Junaid Baghdadi, "Hazrat, can you teach me something which can draw me closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and bring me closer to people as well? Bring me closer to Allah and bring me closer to the people as well. I can be accepted. People can like me and love me. So give me, Allah can like me and love me, and people also like me and love me. Give me some anecdote and some advice for this." And he said, "Amma alladhi yuqarribuka ila Allah fa mas'alatuhu wa amma athani fatarku mas'alatihim." The thing that can bring you closer to Allah is begging from Allah. Always beg from Allah. Always be humble. Make lengthy du'as. Always show your humility, humbleness, and like a beggar who shows his humility to someone who is begging. So beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for your needs, because Allah loves that person who begs from Him. So always ask your needs from none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any problem, any calamity, anything you need, just perform wudu, pray two rakat salatul hajat, ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every time you make dua after namaz, after faraz namaz, after tahajjud namaz, after nafil namaz, after awabin, show your zeal and your eagerness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And make dua from the depth of your heart with utmost concentration. So this will bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And وَأَمَّا الثَّانِي فَتَرْكُ مَسْأَلَتِهِمْ. And the second thing which you ask, that you want to be closer to Allah, closer to the people, so people also like you, then the advice for that is, don't ask anything from people. Because people don't like that person who asks from them. So ask Allah and you will be close to Allah. And don't ask people and you will be close to people. Don't develop that greed in your heart. Wherever you go, oh, this is really nice. Can I have this? Can you give me this? Can you give me that? This greed in your heart, this will drive you away from people. Take that away from your heart. Don't ask anyone from anything. Not even your brother, not even your father, not even your friend. Whatever you need, do take it for yourself. Don't ask for anybody. Can I borrow your car? Can I have this much money? Can I have that? Can I have this? People don't like that. You'll drive you away. So Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi gave very nice advice. If you want to grow closer to Allah, ask from him. Be closer to people, don't ask anything from anyone. He used to say, لِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ صَفْوَةٌ وَصَفْوَةُ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ الصُّوفِيَّةِ. Every ummat had some chosen people in them. Ummat of Musa alayhi salam, ummat of Isa alayhi salam, they had their hawariyin, and they had their companions of Sahaba of Musa alayhi salam, and the companions of Ibrahim alayhi salam, Nuh alayhi salam, Adam alayhi salam. لكل ummatin safwatun. Every ummat nation had some chosen people by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَصَفْوَةُ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ الصُّوفِيَّةُ. And the chosen people in this ummah are the Sufis, the Sufiya kiram. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen them especially for their love. They remember, they sit down, they concentrate upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Someone once said that it should be the ulama. And Junaid Baghdadi said, okay, take this something which was what you call, which could injure. And he said, throw it among that group of Sufis who are sitting there. So he took it and he threw it at them. And they all just jumped and they said, Allah. They all screamed Allah's name. And he said, now go over there and you see those ulama of Zahir, throw it on them. And he went and threw it at them. He said, and they start angry. Hey, who threw this over here? And they started shouting. He said, can you see? These are the people chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their attention immediately directed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they take the name of Allah upon any problem which comes upon them. That is why I say they are the chosen people by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi once said, he was asked, man al-arif? Who is arif billah? Who is that person who has gnosis and ma'rifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And he said, man nataqa an sirrik wa anta sakit. Arif billah is that person who speaks your mind while you are quiet, while you are silent. That person is arif billah. Allahu Akbar. Who speaks your mind while you are quiet. That person is arif billah. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi himself, in the beginning, he would, you know, shun the luxuries of this world. He would be a very shy person. And he would not sit down to give any speeches and lectures. His uncle, Sari Sakati rahmatullah alayhi, saw that he has the ability. He is a very talented person and he will benefit people. So his uncle told him that, oh Junaid, sit on the minbar and talk to people and give some advice, do some bayans. And he said, No. I'm okay with my tasbih, with my ibadat. That is alright for me. He told him once, twice, three times. But Junaid said, he was a very shy person. So because of his shyness and haya and sharam, modesty and hashmat, he refused. One night, he saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in a dream. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Ya Junaid, takallam ala nas. Oh Junaid, go and talk among people, give your speech among people. And he got up in the morning. And he came to his uncle's house before Fajr time. And his uncle was busy in his ibadat. After tahajjud, he was performing his wazaif and awrad. So he knocked the door. And his uncle, Sari Sakati, without hearing anything, he called from inside, you didn't listen to me until you were told by the higher court. And he said, that morning, after Fajr, he sat down to give his lecture. And when he sat down, in the beginning, few people came. And the word spread around that Junaid Baghdadi has started giving lectures. And people started flocking to his lecture to come and listen. And they benefit. One young man came who was wearing a jubba, a libas, like a normal pious person. And he said, oh Junaid, what is the meaning of the hadith? اتَّقُوا فِرَاسَةَ الْمُؤْمِنِ فَإِنَّهُ يَنْظُرُ بِنُورِ اللَّهِ. Beware of the foresight and the firasat of the mu'min, the true believer. Because he sees with the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning a wali of Allah, a friend of Allah, don't underestimate his ability and his caliber. Because he is blessed with the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He can see what you can't see. So this is a hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. And it's clear. Sayyiduna Uthman Ghani radiallahu anhu was once sitting in one of his sessions. And people would come and go. And Uthman Ghani radiallahu anhu would say some advice, give some advice, say some words. So he made a remark. And he said, what is it that people come in my majlis and their eyes have committed zina? He was pointing out at someone who had just come to him through the markets and he had unlawfully gazed at some na-mahram, ghair mahram. So Uthman Ghani radiallahu anhu, he saw with the noor of his heart, from with the noor of his firasat, that this person's eyes have that unlawful gaze in it. And this can be seen by awliyaullah. Hazrat Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi, he was performing wudu in the wudu khan. A young man came and sat by his side and he started doing wudu. And Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi, could see the sins dropping with the water of wudu which was dropping. And he said, Yabna akhi, tub ila Allahi min az-zina. Dear son, you know, make tawbah from zina. I can see the zina dropping with the water which is dropping from your wudu. Another time, someone else was doing wudu by his side, young boy, and he said, Yabna akhi, tub ila Allahi min al-uquq. Dear son, make tawbah from disobeying your parents, from abusing your parents. I can see that abuse and insult of your parents going dropping with the wudu water which is dripping. So the awliyaullah, sometimes they can see. This is firasatul mu'min. Allah shows them. So Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi was sitting in the beginning. He has just started delivering his lectures. And someone comes and he says, what is the meaning of this hadith? So Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah lowered his head for a while. And then he raised it. And he said, take off your zunnar and say the kalma la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Your time has come. This person was originally a Christian. He had come to test Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi. And beneath his jubba, he was wearing the zunnar, which was the custom of the Christians of that time, the belt which they used to have on their waist. So he said, take off your belt and embrace Islam. And he took off that belt immediately and he said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu. This is Junaid Baghdadi right at the beginning when he has just sat down. So imagine, this was at the age of 20, 22, when he was when he started giving his lectures and giving his fatwas and giving his advices. So Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi was of a very, very high caliber. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi was a very sahibe firasat buzurg. Baz mashayikh, they have that condition of the heart, you know, where their tawajjuh and their attention can focus on someone and they can converse with them through the heart. They might be here and someone else might be somewhere else and their conversation would be among their hearts. And this is mentioned in hadith. The Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, inna ar-ruhayna layaltaqiyani wa baynahuma masiratu shahrin. In Adabul Mufrad, this hadith is there. That sometimes two ruhs and souls meet up, even though there is a gap of 1 month between them. One person is here, other person is 1,000 miles away. But their ruhs connect and join, and they have conversation with one another. This is in the hadith. Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi was a sheikh of this type. He, one of his students, Abu Amr ibn al-Aun, says that once I was in Rahbatul Kufa. Kufa is a large city of Iraq. And Baghdad is the capital city of Iraq. There is a long, huge distance between them. So he says, I was in Kufa, I was going for a janazah. And on the way to janazah, while we were passing by, we were waiting there, my eyes fell on a handsome young girl and I started to stare at her. And that lust I have developed in the heart, astaghfirullah, we should try and avoid that. May Allah protect us. So he said, I looked at her and I stared at her. And after that, tawbah, astaghfirullah. But we prayed the janazah and then we came back. While I was coming back home, I passed by the homes of people and this old lady who was pious, and she was standing outside and she saw me and she said, oh, Ibn al-Aun, what's up with your face? It's gone black. Why has your face gone black? And he says, I was shocked. I came home, I looked in the mirror, my face had gone black. And I realized, this is the effect of that evil stare and that gaze, which I did, and with that lustful gaze on that handsome young girl. And I said, Tawbah, astaghfirullah, I did istighfar, I did some ibadah, give some sadqah, this, that, zikr, fikr. But that effect would not go away. And I was going through a hard time. A few days passed in this state, and my condition was like that of a person who is constricted. And that openness evaded me and went away. I could not do ibadah of Allah with the bashashat I would normally do. I did not have that bashashat, that easiness and flowing of the ibadat and the tilawat and zikr, fikr, and that effect, that crying effect, and it had all deserted me. So I tried my utmost, but it just wouldn't go away. My friend saw me in this terrible state, and he said that, why are you so disturbed? He said, I don't know, yaar, this condition has overcome me, it's this qabz, and it's not going away. So he said, why don't you go to your Sheikh, Junaid Baghdadi? Go to him, stay in his company for a few days. Inshallah, your condition will return, and your previous original state of good health will be restored. So he said, yeah, I never thought of that. And he traveled from Rahabatul Kufa to Baghdad. When he arrived, Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi was busy in his wasaif. And when he arrived, Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi looked at him and he said, "Anta tudhnibu bir rahaba wa yustaghfaru laka bi Baghdad." You commit sin in Rahabatul Kufa, and istighfar is being done for you over here in Baghdad. Allahu Akbar. How did Junaid Baghdadi know that he had committed that sin? This is the mulaqat of the arwah. The souls they meet. When your Shaykh is here, he is doing istighfar for you. Allah opens up that for him. Your Shaykh is not God, but Allah opens it for him because of your bond and your connection with your Shaykh, and he does istighfar for him. Amen. Have you not heard Imam Fakhruddin Razi rahmatullah's condition at the time of his death? Imam Fakhruddin Razi rahmatullah, a great Imam, a great philosopher. He was on his deathbed, and Shaitan approaches him. And he says, "Oh Fakhruddin, you say that Allah is one? Okay, give me a dalil, prove that Allah is one." And he gave the dalil of the philosophers, that this is the proof, Allah is one. But Shaitan said, no, there is flaw in there, and he broke that dalil. And gave me another one, and he gave another dalil. And I said, no, there is flaw in there as well, you know. And he made some contradiction in that dalil and evidence, proof which he gave. One after the other, Fakhruddin Razi is giving the dalils and evidences, but Shaitan is breaking them, breaking them all. So Razi is shaken. His Shaykh was somewhere else performing wudu for Salah. Allah opened that condition to his Shaykh. And his Shaykh immediately, while he was finishing the wudu, he threw the lota and he said, "Keh de main bila dalil ke khuda ko ek manta hoon." Say, "I believe that Allah is one without any dalil. I don't need to give you any dalil." And Fakhruddin Razi Ramtullah said that, and Shaitan just immediately ran away, and he died with Kalma La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Because Allah loved Fakhruddin Razi. Allah wanted to save his iman, protect his iman because of his khidmat for deen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected his Shaykh. So over here as well, Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi was of a very high status. One of his students, Ja'far al-Khaladi, says Khair ibn Abdullah al-Nassaj says, One day I was sitting in my house, and I got a feeling in my heart that Junaid is at the door, so open it. So I said, no, this is a waswasa. So I just rejected it. Then after a while, that thought came again, Junaid is at the door, open it. And I said, no, this is a waswasa. And a third time, I got up, I opened the door, and there is Junaid Baghdadi standing there. And he said, "Why didn't you open it the first time?" So this is something heart to heart. These akabir awliyaullah, they are of, you just can't estimate their ranks in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah gives them that rank. I don't know whether I should say this or not. My Hazrat is also a Shaykh of this type. Many times we have noticed this, that something comes in the heart, and then Hazrat's instruction or some letter or something comes of that type. I remember when I was studying in Saharanpur, Hazrat told me to study Mukhtasarul Maani, Sharhul Aqaid, and other two kitabs. So I got admission into Sharh al-Aqaid and Mabzi and other books, but I couldn't get admission into Mukhtasar al-Ma'ani. So I did my best, but because of the clash of the ghantas and the timings, I couldn't get admission in there. I said, okay, leave it. One day I was just sitting, you know, in my room, and I got the feeling that, you know, I should study Mukhtasar al-Ma'ani because Hazrat instructed me, and I shouldn't abandon it. And I went to Maulana Salman Saab and I requested him, can you please teach me Mukhtasar al-Ma'ani? And he gave me a time. He said, okay, you come to me after Asr and I will teach you privately. And we started the lesson. Exactly 1 week after this incident, Hazrat's letter comes and Hazrat instructed in there, have you started your Mukhtasar al-Ma'ani lessons or not? And I thought to myself, amazing. Here I was getting this feeling when Hazrat was writing over there. He was writing that letter and I was getting this feeling over here. The rules, when they are connected, they have that effect. Like Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. And this is easy to understand these days, my friends. Mobile phone, communication, email, text messages. You are here, someone is somewhere else, and you are connected with one another. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept that effect in the inner parts of the heart where the souls connect with one another. They have that munasabat with one another. And when the ruhs are attached with one another, you become one and you get that effect. You see, Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, he is concerned about the affairs of the armies which he sends out. And he is standing on the mimbar giving khutbah. And he is worried about this jung of Nihavand, which I have spoke to you. The Nihavand jung was taking place. And in that battle, the leader of one of the armies was named Saria. His name was Saria. So Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu is here, he's giving his Juma khutbah. And suddenly he says, Ya Saria al-Jabal, Ya Saria al-Jabal, Ya Saria al-Jabal. O Saria, be careful from the side of the mountain. Be careful from the side of the mountain. And people are asking me, why? He has a khutbah between khutbah, he is saying this somewhere. Where is it coming from? Anyhow, he finished his khutbah, finished his salah. And then when he was sitting, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf and others asked him, Sayyiduna Amirul Mu'minin, are you okay? What is this? Ya Sari al Jabal, Ya Sari al Jabal. And he said, well, I was giving my khutbah and suddenly Allah opened everything before me and I could see the Muslim army fighting in Nihavan and they were about to be attacked from the side of mountain and I called out Ya Sari al Jabal and directed them towards that side. And they protected themselves from that side. And he said, this is what happened. Now the incident was gone, happened, forgotten. After a few weeks, when the news comes from Nihavand that Alhamdulillah, the battle was won, among the instructions, the bearer of the news says that we were about to be attacked from our behind and suddenly a voice came out from the unseen that Al-Jabal, Ya Sari Al-Jabal, Ya Sari Al-Jabal, and we protected ourselves from there and we won the battle. What is this? The rules are connected. So Allah opens it up over here and he can see that condition over there. This is Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi's condition as well. Some are because of their zikr and fikr, because of their tilawat, because of their zikr, 30,000 tasbihat throughout the day, 300 nafal rakaz. Can anybody do that? This is what takes them to that status and makes them Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi. Ibn Suraj al-Faqih says that, you know, Ibrahim ibn Haddad says, I would go in Ibn Suraj al-Faqih al-Shafi'i's majlis. And he would deliver beautiful lectures. And he would say things which we would have never heard from anywhere. And he would talk in furu' and usul in a beautiful manner. So when he saw that I was amazed at his lecture, he realized. And he said to me, Atadri min ayna haza? Do you know where this is coming from? And I said, no. And he said, Hada bi barakati Abil Qasim al Junaid. This is all barakat of my Shaykh Abu al-Qasim al-Junaid. It is his tawajjuh and his du'as which have made me and taken me up to this caliber where I can deliver this type of lecture. This is Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi. Hazrat Abu Amr al-Zujaji rahmatullahi alayhi says that once I went to Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi and I was intending to go for Hajj. So Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi took out one beautiful newly made dirham coin and he gave it to me and he said, take this, a gift. I took it and out of respect, you know, I tied it with my ihram or my chadar very securely because I did not want to lose it. And then he says, after that when I travel for Hajj, wherever I would camp or, you know, stay, people would come with me, the rufaqa and my companions of the journey, they would bring me food and they would bring me water and drink and everything. I never needed to spend anything. And I went for Hajj and I spent my time in Hajj and I returned to Baghdad and the dirham was in its original condition. When I came to meet Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi, he stretched his hand out and he said, give me my dirham back. How was my dirham? So this was the barakat of dirham. I never knew that it was Hazrat Tawajjuh which was doing all that tasarruf and which was helping me throughout the journey. Also, many other karamat of Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi written over here. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi says, one night I got up for my tahajjud and I was trying to pray my tahajjud and my wazaif, but I just couldn't get that feeling and that halawat and sweetness. I didn't know what was happening. I tried to lie down for a few minutes, but I couldn't sleep as well. Again, I tried to sit up and do my tasbihat, but I couldn't. And suddenly the house started to shake, something like when you get on an earthquake. So something started to shake, so I just got up and I went out. As soon as I went outside, I saw that there was a person sitting there, covered in a shawl, and he raised his head, and he said, إِلَيَّ السَّاعَةَ يَا أَبُوَ الْقَاسِمِ. Abul Qasim, over here a minute please. So I said, this is no time of appointment to come and meet, middle of the night. And he said, بَلْ سَأَلْتُ مُحَرِّكَ الْقُلُوبِ أَنْ يُحَرِّكَ قَلْبَكَ لِلْخُرُوجِ. He said, I know, but I requested that Allah, who shakes the hearts, to shake your heart to bring me here. So he said, I want to ask you a question, and that's why I have come here. مَتَى يَصِيرُ دَاءُ النَّفْسِ دَوَاءَهَا. When does the sickness of the heart become its cure? When does the sickness of the nafs become the cure of the nafs? What can you give me the answer to this question? There are sicknesses in the heart, but when does that same sickness become the medicine and the cure of the heart? And Junaid Baghdadi immediately replied, إِذَا خَالَفَتْ هَوَاهَا. When the nafs goes against its desires, then the nafs itself is providing the cure. Meaning you get the carnal desires, and they are a sickness of the heart. But you go against them, then that is the cure and medicine of the heart. So don't follow your whimsical desires, just oppose them, go against them. And that is the medicine of the sicknesses of the heart. So this is something amazing. Like we read in one kitab, there was this, among the, yogis, you get such people who work on their nafs. And they work on their nafs and they go to such a state that they can control their nafs and, very high caliber. So, all they need is the matches of Iman. If the noor of Iman is given to them, they immediately become wali of Allah. Because they have already opposed their nafs throughout their lifetime. So one such wali of Allah, one wali of Allah once saw this young man who was from the yogis types, who were not yet Muslims. But however, you get this community like the Buddhist, they work on their nafs. And they make it purified, clean it. But they don't have that Iman, that's why they are left behind. If they get that Iman, they can get the Wilayat as well. Because Iman is necessary for Wilayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he had worked on his heart. He was a yogi. He was from the Buddhist type people. So this Wali of Allah was sitting in maybe a ship or somewhere. He was there as well. They started talking with one another. And he asked that person that, you are very high status. How did you achieve this status? And he said, well, my chela, he taught me that I should always oppose my nafs. Whatever my nafs says, I should go against it. If my nafs says eat this, I should say no. If my nafs says go to sleep, I should say no. If my nafs says go over there, I should say no. If my nafs says look at this, I should say no. Whatever my nafs says, I should go against it. And I always held on to this. And this is how I achieve this high status of spirituality. So the Buzrug Wali of Allah said to him, say kalma la ilaha illallah. He said, no. Your guru taught you. You should go against your nafs. Your nafs is saying don't say kalma. And it's your guru's and your guru's advice that you should go against your nafs. So say kalma la ilaha illallah. And he said, you've caught me here. I said, I'm not saying, no, you have to go against your nafs. And he said, all right. And he said, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, from the depth of his heart. He embraced Islam. And immediately he went to the high ranks of wilayat. Because his nafs was clean. His nafs, he did not have those sicknesses and ailments inside it. So Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi was called out, and this person asked, Mata yasiru da'un nafsi dawa'aha? And he replied, Ida khalafat hawaha. When the nafs goes against his whimsical desires, then the sicknesses themselves become the medicine and the cure of the heart. And that person who was sitting outside, he said to his nafs, Isma'i ya nafsi, qad ajabtuki bihada sab'an, fa abayti illa an tasma'ihi min al-junaid, thumman sarafa, falam a'rifu. And he said, oh nafs, look and listen carefully what Junaid has said. I have given you same reply, this same answer 7 times, but you don't want to listen to me. You wanted to listen to Junaid. Here, Junaid, he has given you the answer. And the person left, and Junaid Baghdadi says, I came back inside and I started my wazaif, and I got that halawat and sweetness inside my wazaif. So this is the condition of the mashayikh, of the Sufiya. Ali ibn Abi Mansur al-Dinuri says, once I went to Baghdad, I had some money and I wanted to spend it upon Junaid Baghdadi and his companions, which I did. And I stayed in the company of Junaid Baghdadi, rahmatullahi alayhi. He was very happy with me. He brought me closer to himself, and he was very kind to me. And I used to go to him every day. One night I saw in a dream that in the dream, the Khalifa of the time, the king of the time, ruler, he came to me and invited me for ziyafat, for mehmani. So I woke up and I related this dream to my friend. So I saw the king come to me and invite me for food, for mehmani. So my friend said, we should wait and see how the interpretation comes of this dream. So after Fajr Salah, when we had performed our wazaif, Fajr, we were sitting in our room. Suddenly someone knocked on the door. I opened the door and there was Junaid Baghdadi standing there before me. So we stood up and we were really happy upon seeing him. He said salam and he sat for a moment, and then we talked, had some conversation. Then he invited me to his house for food, for mehmani. So I looked at my friend and I smiled. And I said, look, the interpretation is here. So Junaid said, why are you smiling? And I said, this is something I saw in a dream just last night. And I was waiting for the interpretation, and the interpretation has come in the form of you yourself knocking the door and inviting me. So they went to the house of Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi. They sat down and again they started smiling. So Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi says that last night I saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in my dream. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was sitting on his right, and Umar Farooq radiyallahu anhu was sitting on his left, and Ali karramallahu wajhahu was sitting in front of him. So I also went and sat in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Suddenly two men came with a dispute and sat in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. One had put a claim on the other and was asking him for his haq and his right. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned towards me and said, Ya Abul Qasim, uhkum baynahuma. O Abul Qasim, judge between them. So I kept quiet due to the respect of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I felt shy in front of the Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhi majma'in that I should speak there. I'm a small person. I should not speak in front of them. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam again instructed me, and a third time he instructed me, but I could not speak out of the haybat and awe and respect of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The fourth time he said, uhkum baynahuma faqad wallaytuka al-hukma bayn al-khalq. Judge between them, because I have made you made you responsible for judging between the makhluq, between the creation. Allahu Akbar. This is what that person was seeing as the Khalifa coming to him in his dream. So in reality, in the outward, the Khalifa is whoever is the Khalifa in Baghdad. But in reality, in the spirituality, the ruler and the Khalifa and the judge was Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is giving him the honor and the governance of the hukm and judge between the makhluq. And he says, Junaid Baghdadi says, when I saw this dream, I just woke up. and I was sort of, you know, shaken. So I came to you, and so that I can talk to you and get some tasalli and solace and, you know, feel at ease. That's why I came to you. So this is the reality of that other world in which things takes place over there. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi says in another place, once I was among his karamat. This is, I'm relating from Jami'u Karamat al-Awliya of Sheikh Yusuf al-Nabhani rahmatullahi alayhi. He says that Junaid Baghdadi says, I was standing in Masjid al-Shonis and I was waiting for a janazah to pray salatul janazah upon it. And there was a huge crowd over there waiting for the janazah to come. And I saw a faqir in whose appearance there were signs of worship, that he is a good person. However, he was asking from people. So I said in my heart, not with my tongue, I just thought in my mind that if this person would do some mehnat and hard work and earn his daily bread, then that would be better for him than going out and asking people. This thought came to my mind. However, after when janazah was finished, when I came home and I had my wazifa at night, I prayed my wazaif and awrad, but I tried to, but I couldn't. So I couldn't continue with the wazaif in the manner which I normally would. And I spent the night, you know, awake, sitting, couldn't sleep. And I was thinking about the reason for that. And while I was sitting, I just dozed off. And while dozing off, I saw a dream. And I saw that faqir who was asking from people was made to lie on a sort of a deck or something, and he was being carried on that plaque of wood, and he was brought before me, and the person who brought, he said, eat from his meat. I said, astaghfirullah, this is a human being, I cannot eat from his meat. And the person said, well, you did his ghibat while you were standing in the janazah. So I said, I didn't say anything, it was just something that came to my mind. And the person said, even though that is also ghibat, why did you think bad about the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He said that the person in the dream said, go and get maafi from him, and you know, get pardon from him, ask him to forgive you. So Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah says, I woke up in the morning and I went to that place where I had seen that faqir, and I tried to look for him, I couldn't find him. Then I went to the river banks where the fuqara go around, and I saw him, that he was on the kinara of the Nehr and the river bank, where there are some vegetables, and he was picking some lettuce or some vegetable, beans or something, from the side which is growing or thrown over there. So I went to him, approached him, and I said, Assalamu alaik. And he replied. And without me saying anything, he said, Ya Abul Qasim, ta'udu. Abul Qasim, will you make that mistake again? And he said, I said, La a'udu. And he said, Ghafar Allahu lana wa lak. I said, may Allah forgive you and forgive me as well. So this is something over there. May Allah protect us from doing ghibat of people. Junaid Baghdadi only thought this, but still he was of such a high caliber that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested him for that. That Junaid, you are of such a high status. You say this, you should never think that type as well. Never even think about ghibat. Never mind saying ghibat. Get the thought of ghibat out of your mind as well. Forget speaking about it. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah says, one night in a dream I saw Iblis, Mal'oon, and he was naked. So I said to him, Ya Mal'oon, Ama tastahyi min al-nas? Oh Mal'oon, are you not ashamed of people? You're wandering around naked among people? Because there was a crowd, people, and he was walking naked, nude, without anything, no clothes at all. So he said, he looked at me and he said, Ya Abul Qasim, do you think these people are people? Do you think these are people? Human beings are not left in this day and age. All human beings have gone. The real human beings, do you know who they are? They are sitting in Masjid-e-Shunis. Go and see them. They are the human beings. They are insan. These people are not insan. If they were insan, I would not come naked in front of them. They are not insans. They have become like haywans. So there is no harm in going around naked in them. The insans, if you want to see, go and see them in Masjid-e-Shunis. He said that قَدْ أَضْنَوْ جَسَدِي وَأَحْرَقُوا كَبِدِي وَأَنْحَلُوا جِسْمِي. They have weakened my body, and they have burnt my liver, and they have made me frail. So every time I attempt to attack them, they pray to Allah and Allah's wrath falls upon me and I am burned and I have to run away and flee from them. I can't even approach them, never mind inciting them and doing waswasa upon them. So if you want to see them, go to Masjid Shoniz and look at them. So Junaid Baghdadi says, I woke up and it was night, during the night. So I woke up and I went straight to Masjid Shoniz and I saw three men sitting in three corners. In one corner was Abu Hassan al-Nuri rahmatullahi alayhi. In the other corner was Abu Ali al-Daqaq rahmatullahi alayhi. And in the other corner was Abu Uthman al-Hayri rahmatullahi alayhi. So I went in them and they were busy in their muraqabah and they had lowered their heads into their knees and busy covered themselves with the chadar and in their muraqabah. And one of them raised their head and he said, Ya Abul Qasim, la yaghurrannaka hadithul khabis. Oh, Abu al-Qasim, don't be deceived by the talk of that khabis. I hadn't even related my dream to them. How did they know? This is the mulaqat of the ruhs. And he said that, oh, Abu al-Qasim, don't listen to what that khabis says and don't pay any attention to it. So, this is Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi, rahmatullahi alayhi, and his condition. And you can talk and talk and talk about Junaid Baghdadi. This whole book is about Junaid Baghdadi, rahmatullahi alayhi. How can you go on and on and on? These are just some scattered pearls from the life of Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi. And remember, he did not become wali of Allah just like that. We have said 300 rakats every day and 30,000 tasbihat. And on top of that, the recitation of the Quran. In fact, recitation of Quran, he had so much love for Quran that in the incident of his death, Marazul Wafat, Abu Muhammad al-Jariri says, his student, I was with Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi at the time of his sakarat, when he was in the pangs of death. It was Friday and he was reciting Quran. He says that he completed the recitation of the Quran. He started Surah Al-Baqarah and he read 70 ayat from Surah Al-Baqarah and then he passed away. He says, when he was in that condition, I said to him, Ya Abu al-Qasim, fi hadhihi al-hala, O Abu al-Qasim, you are reading Quran in this state, in this condition, you are in your sakarat, you know, you should be lying down and you should be in the pains of death. And he said, وَمَنْ أَوْلَى بِذَا مِنِّي تُطْوَى صَحِيفَتِي. What better time to recite the Quran than this? My a'mal nama, my book of deeds is being closed now. It's being closed. I can't put anything else in there now. My last moments are there. Let me add in there as much hasanat as I can. And what better zikr than the tilawat of Quran? And another place, Abu Bakr al-Attar says that I was by Junaid before his death. And we were with a group of people. And I saw that Junaid rahmatullahi alayhi was sitting and busy in his salah and his prayers. And he had turned one of his legs away. However, you know, because of the ruku and sajda while sitting down, he could not make the movements. So his feet had swollen. And so he stretched his legs out and he started praying salah with ishara. And he kept performing praying salah. So someone said to him, Ma haza ya Abul Qasim? What is this, O Abul Qasim? You know, you are, you know, your last moments, maybe your death time is near and you are performing salah in this state. And he said, Hadhihi ni'matun. This is also a blessing of Allah that he has given me the tawfiq to pray during my last days or last moments, last times. And he said, Allahu Akbar, and started his salah again. When he finished his salah, Abu Muhammad al-Jariri, his student, said, Lawid tajahta, if you would lie down for a moment. And he said, Ya Aba Muhammad, hada waqtun yukhazu minhu. O Abu Muhammad, this is the time to take something from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. He started salah again. And he kept on praying until his last moments. Ibn Ata says, I went to Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi, and he was in his naza' and he was in his sakarat. I did salam to him and he did not reply. After a while, he replied. And he said, "Uzurni fa inni kuntu fi wirdi." Excuse me, because I was reading my wird and wazifa. And then he kept on reciting and reciting. And then he turned his face towards the qibla, and then he passed away. Someone was sitting there, and he said, in the halat of naza' sakarat, "Qul la ilaha illallah." Say la ilaha illallah. And Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi replied, "Ma nasituhu fa azkurahu." I have never forgotten la ilaha illallah, that I should be reminded today. I have always remembered it, and alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, I have never forgotten this kalma. He, Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi, passed away on Friday, after Asr, before Maghrib, just as the sun was setting on that side, here the sun of Tasawwuf was also setting, and he was handing his soul to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He passed away on Friday, in the month of Shawwal, in the year 298 after Hijrah. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi, while during his last moments, he said to his student, Abu Muhammad al-Jariri, "Oh Abu Muhammad, I want to give you two instructions. One is, when I die, you know, give me ghusl swiftly, quickly, and give me a simple kafan, and bury me as soon as possible." I said, "No problem." Another, what is the second instruction? Second instruction, he said, "All these friends of ours who have gathered over here for my last moments, make sure that you make a feast for them and feed them properly. I don't want any of my friends to stay hungry or go away from here while they are hungry." So he said, I started crying that he's on his deathbed and he is so concerned about the state of affairs of his friends. He wants to feed them. Even on his deathbed, he is being generous and sakhi. And I said to myself that looking at his condition, his sakhawat, and keeping everyone together, this togetherness will not prevail after he is gone. And that is what happened. As soon as he passed away, everybody else went on his ways and we were all scattered. While Junaid was there, we were all as one unit and attached to Hazrat Junaid rahmatullahi alayhi. When Hazrat Junaid rahmatullahi alayhi passed away, how many people performed his janaza? It is estimated that nearly 60,000 people participated in his janaza. And he was buried in the qabrastan of a Shoniziya, where in Shoniz there are other great mashayikhs and awliyaullah also buried over there. Ja'far al-Khaladi says that after the death of Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi, I saw him in a dream and I asked him, "Ma fa'alallahu bika?" How did Allah treat you and how did you fare in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And he said, "Ya Ja'far, طاحت تلك الإشارات وغابت تلك العبارات ونفدت تلك الرسوم وفنيت تلك العلوم وما نفعنا إلا ركيعات كنا نركعها بالأسحار." He said, Ja'far, all those isharat and that high words of wisdom of tasawwuf, they all faded away. And all those ibarat which we used to speak, they also came to no help and no avail. And all the uloom which we used to spread, they also came to no avail. What benefited me over here were the few rak'ats which we used to pray at tahajjud time. These were the most valuable and precious moments and parts of my life which assisted me in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi. Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi's teachers, we mentioned Hadith ibn Asad al-Muhasibi, Sari Saqati, Abu Thawr, Abu Ja'far al-Qassab, Abu Ja'far al-Kurni, Abu Ali al-Masuhi. Among his mu'asideen, contemporaries, are Dhunnun al-Misri, Sahl ibn Abdullah al-Tustui, Abu Sa'id al-Khazaz, Ruwaym ibn Ahmad al-Baghdadi, Abu al-Hasan al-Nuri, Ahmad ibn Abil Hawari, Khair ibn Abdullah al-Nassaj, Yahya ibn Mu'adh al-Razi, Abu al-Abbas Ahmad ibn Ata, Abu Ishaq Ibrahim al-Khawwas, Abu Abdullah ibn al-Jala, Amr ibn Uthman al-Makki, Husayn ibn Mansur al-Hallaj. These are all his contemporaries. And his students and his khulafa, there is a huge list of them mentioned over here in this book. Among them, a few famous ones are Abu Muhammad al-Jadiri, Abu Sa'id ibn al-A'rabi, Abu Bakr al-Shibli. Shibli, whose name we hear all the time. Abu Bakr al-Shibli is the khalifa and student of Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayhi. He used to say, "Why have I been given the title Shibli?" He said, "Once I saw Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in my dream. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to me, Ya Aba Bakr, Shib li." Shib, Shaba Yashibu Shayban, means to grow old, to have grey hair. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to me in my dream, "Ya Aba Bakr, Shib li." Oh Abu Bakr, become old and have grey hair for my sake. Meaning spend your time in my ibadat and get white hair on your face during my ibadat. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in one hadith, "Man shaba shaybatan fil Islam kanat lahu nuran yawm al-qiyamah." Whosoever's hair grows white and safed in the khidmat of the service of deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then those white hair will be a source of nur for him on the day of qiyamah. The amount of white hair he has, they will bring nur for his, on his face on the day of Qiyamah. So he said to me, Ya Abu Bakr, Shibli. That's why I was given the title Shibli. So Abu Bakr al-Shibli, he was also a great wali of Allah, great saint of his time. There was a time when he used to say to the people of Baghdad. People of Baghdad would say that he is mad, he is a majnoon, he is a diwana, he is insane. But Shibli would say, Ana amanun li ahli hadhihi al-ard. I am security for the people of this city and this town. As long as I am here, the people of this city will be protected. People wouldn't understand what he was saying. However, when he passed away, after some time, the Tataris and the Suljukis attacked Baghdad, and the whole Baghdad was torn to pieces. And then people realized, when he said, I am the security of this city, this is what he meant. So Abu Bakr al-Shibli, among his khulafa, and Bunan al-Hammal, Abu al-Abbas ibn Suraj, Abu Ali al-Ruzbari, one of the great saints, Abu Muhammad al-Murta'ish, Abu Bakr al-Kattani, Abu Abdullah ibn Khufayf, Abu Hafs ibn Shaheen, these are all included among the khulafa of Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayh. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raise the ranks and elevate the status of Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayh. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala benefit us from the halat which we have just learned of Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayh. And just like last time, one request: give some sadaqah on behalf of Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullahi. Will you do so inshallah? Maybe 5 pounds, 10 pounds, whatever you can. Isale sawab for Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah. Inshallah, you will see the benefit for that. And the ruh of Hazrat Junaid Baghdadi will be directed towards you. You will get his ruhani and spiritual du'as. Because these awliyaullah...